Hey, I'm Chase.
And I'm Simon.
From On the Table Gaming. And today we're going to talk about
Simon
and the Masters of the Universe.
All right. So, Simon, big news today. So, Simon revealed its next big Kickstarter project, and it is Masters of the Universe Class Returnia. All right. How excited are you?
I'm pretty excited, you know. I think Masters of the Universe hit. I'm going to give away my age here a little bit. So, just in general terms, I think I was about like eight, nine when it first came out. And I was into sort of G.I. Joe's Action Force, as it was in the UK. Of course, we didn't have proper G.I. Joe. We had another version of it. So when Master of the Universe came out, the figures are pretty chunky. They're big, you know. And
like looking in the mirror, right?
Yeah, exactly. It's more like my build. I just thought, well, you know, these guys take care of themselves. So, yeah, I can relate to this. But they were bigger figures. And I was a little bit afraid of He-Man because of the hair and the muscles and lack of clothing. I didn't really know what to think of it, but I liked some of the other characters, and they were pretty popular at school. There was obviously the cartoon, so that was cool. Again, a bit cringe at some points, but overall it was fun, you know, and it had She-Ra for my sister. So I kind of enjoyed it. I thought it was pretty cool, but it's so pervasive in pop culture. Everything that most people look back on, kind of like Star Wars, you know, you look back on these kind of things and you think to yourself, oh, I remember this, and you look back fondly on it. So I'm really happy that this type of childhood experience has been reimagined by Simon. I'm very keen to see what they've got them put together.
Absolutely. And me too. I mean, I'm only a little bit younger than you. I'm catching up here a little bit. But for me, my memories, man, I absolutely just adored He-Man. And in fact, I think like, maybe my only like purchased Halloween costume as a kid. My family, we always made our Halloween costumes, but you couldn't make He-Man. And boy, if anyone remembers the He-Man costume, I'm afraid to dig up a photo and show it. But it was literally just like a plastic body bag you wore, like a bag, and it had muscles printed on it, and a glow in the dark sword, and then a little plastic mask with a rubber band. Huge fan, and this has definitely rekindled some of those memories and the nostalgia of that, you know, earlier, somewhat simpler time. And, you know, I'm over the moon and excited to see what Simon does with this project.
I would say that probably give me flashbacks. I'm not sure that would be good. But one thing I'm going to insist on right now, seeming that you offered, is the fact that the photo will appear on the screen right now of you with the He-Man costume, because that's what everybody wants to see, right? So that's definitely going to happen, and you'll put it on the screen for everybody to see. So awesome. Look forward to that, folks.
So if you're just tuning in here, we're going to be covering this game closely because it's something that is near and dear to our hearts. And today with the Kickstarter announcement, they revealed a lot of information. Not only did we get to see some sculpts, but they talked about their new mechanic, or I guess they're calling it the power system, which seems to be like a new chassis for how they may be doing the series of games, maybe.
Yeah, I don't think they expanded on it too much, but it seemed like there was a little bit more to the power system than just potentially what we heard today. So it's really interesting. Obviously, just taking a step back from this before we get into the game itself, because I do know that there's multiple projects around the He-Man property. So basically what we're going to be focusing on is Simon's game, which I believe is Clash of Eternia, correct?
Correct.
Right. There's another one which is based in Europe, and that is Fields of Eternia by Archon Games.
And that one's going to be a Europe-only release. And one thing that's exciting with the Simon one is that it's a global release. It's going to be everywhere but Europe. And that's some sort of licensing issue. I think there's different Mattel branches. I don't really know exactly how it works.
Yeah, if you actually, it's quite interesting. If you look at the Toys That Made Us, I think it is its Netflix show where they cover off different types of like toy manufacturers. You can tell these licenses and the way they work. It's a weird setup system. So, you know, if you want to check that out, then I think people get some insight as to how these licensing arrangements are managed. But like you're absolutely correct. Simon are worldwide except Europe. And I think some people are saying that the project's just North America, but if you're in Asia, if you're in Australasia, etc., you will be able to get this project. And, you know, with the second market with games the way it's being, I'm pretty sure if you really want it, people can get their hands on it. It's a shame, but let's hope that most people can get access to it as required.
So are you ready to jump into Eternity and talk about this then?
Oh, I'm not sure if I'm ready for Eternity, Chase, but I think we have to do it if we're going to do this game justice.
All right. We have a catchphrase or something. I think we can go with I have the power, right? Or is that a trademark here?
If you want to shout that out, please feel free.
I thought, Simon, maybe you want to give it a shot.
By the power of Grayskull.
All right. And here we are. I'm feeling pretty good about this. A big, big Man-at-Arms fan, and let's rock.
Yep. I'm feeling a little bit uncertain about your character choice for me, but I guess it's appropriate. I'm just to be real 100% clear here, I'm not doing the voice, okay? So it's going to be slightly different, but I'm not doing Ram Man's voice, so...
So, you know, you're actually in luck because I think Michael Chenal, the game designer, one of the game designers, he did some pretty good voices on the live stream.
I was super impressed. I'm not sure that he's not connected to the forthcoming Kevin Smith property because those voices were on point, weren't they?
We got to push for more.
Absolutely. Want to hear more Skeletor? What was the other one he did?
He did Beastman.
Perfect. Yes. That's a challenging one to do.
Let's do this. Leave a message in the comments below. What voice would you like Michael Chenal to do next? And the next time they do a live stream, we need to all push for that.
I think he's got Ram Man in him for sure. I think he can manage that one and many other characters. So let's see what he can come up with.
Well, so here we are in Eternia here. And, you know, one of the things that we got to see on stream then that they revealed was a lot of the contents of the core box. So let's just throw up and take a look here at some of the characters that are going to be included when you get the base set of the Eternia core box, starting off with Beastman.
What a way to start. You know, remembering back to the cartoon and the miniatures, the original action figures, one thing which is very clear is that as time goes on, you know, Chase being exactly the same age as me, memories can change over time and develop, and you kind of think things are more significant than they are. And looking back at some of the initial action figures, you can see that they were obviously made using simpler technology. You know, they're very much fun, but they do lack some of the sophistication of modern toys. Now, what I think Simon have done here is they've taken that sort of, they've commingled your childhood aspirations, the original toys, into somewhat other media, which has happened in the Eternia universe over the last 30-odd years. And they've come up with something which I think is uniquely dynamic. I think they've really nailed it in terms of the way that they've presented these miniatures. Really, really cool. And to be honest, it's what I had in mind when I'm looking at a game like this.
I think that's the biggest thing is like sometimes when you step away from these properties and you look back, like in your mind's eye, you remember it a certain way. And we've probably all been there. We've gone back and rewatched a show or some sort of pop culture thing. And you're like, oh, that wasn't exactly how I remembered it looking. But these are like what it seems like, you know, how I'm remembering in my mind's eye what it was like. And these most of the poses we saw here actually are really dynamic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. I love the way that Beastman, you know, just looking at the silhouette, one thing that miniature designers do, especially with like army games, war games, is they develop a silhouette for it. Iconically recognizable on the tabletop. And I think we're seeing this in a miniatures game here. You know, it'd be very easy to have static poses, but they've really gone an extra step here to give something which is really, really lots of fun, but also is going to look great straight out of the box as well. You get it on the table, you're going to see the silhouette. You're going to see how the miniatures look even before you elect to paint them. So I think this is a great move by them.
And during the Q&A, they did talk about some of the gameplay mechanics, and maybe we'll get into that in a little bit. But for Beastman, they did talk about how there will be different styles of play and that he would have an ability to either have like beasts he could command, which makes sense because, you know, Beastman, and that he would also be able to kind of go in like Berserker Super Beast mode. And like he could also be pretty fearsome in hand-to-hand combat. And I think that the pose there just like it kind of evokes that like visceralness of the character.
Put it this way, if I was facing him in a fight, I'd be pretty scared. And if I was one of these minions, again, I would be pretty scared as well. So I think they've achieved that pretty well.
Another miniature we saw was, of course, Orko. And this miniature looks really fantastic. They've got it floating up on a stone. And Orko, of course, has his magic wand in hand as well. And Michael Chenal talked about how for a lot of the characters, you know, you look at this, maybe you don't know the He-Man property that well, and you can kind of be like, oh, he seems kind of like a magician. It gives you an idea of what the character is like, but how they also kind of went another way to find bits of lore to incorporate wherever possible into the sculpt, and having his actual wand there, that's a really nice touch.
I think it is. You know, just looking at this, you know that he's not a melee brawler. You know, he's going to have probably a more strategic role on the tabletop here. But, you know, Orko for me, not one of my favorite characters. I thought he was a bit of a nuisance as growing up and thought, he's always causing problems here. So maybe he'll feature in the game in a similar manner. Maybe he won't always be helpful. I think this is one of the characters that you'll probably want to be playing, isn't it, Chase?
Well, I mean, it's an interesting character for sure. He wasn't always one of my favorites. I think the same thing You know, I guess the question was Orko good at magic? Like that might be debatable.
I think it's a real testament to the patience of the other characters and people in Eternia that they just kept him around all the time because they could sideline him very easily. But no, he's always part of everything.
I did think it was funny when Michael Chennault and Lee Almeida were talking during the Q&A. Lee Almeida is a little bit newer to the property. Michael Chennault, of course, growing up with it. And Leo is saying that, you know, he really came to like Orko. And so he said at some points he was very, very powerful. We'll see what that comes out. And I'm wondering if, you know, Orko will be as much a nuisance as he was in the show.
You know, you raise a great point there because during the live stream, they talked about the concept of power. Mm-hmm. It was very apparent that power features so heavily in the call to arms from the cartoon that this has been featured within this particular property, the way that it's going to be expressed on the tabletop. And I think one thing they mentioned was how power develops during the game. There is a power exchange between player and controller. That's one. So just to cover some of the core mechanics, I know that you have some notes on this, Chase, but yep. Potentially what happens is it's a multiple player game with potentially a solo mode with AI, first of all. Now, I would expect that the most fun you get out of this is playing with friends. Let's face it. When we were growing up in the playground and everyone took a character, I was Ram Man. So this explains a lot why I've been animated as Ram Man today. So my parka zipped all the way to the top. And unfortunately that was the only character left, but I made it mine. You know, I lived it. I was a good Ram Man, but
did you think I wasn't paying attention when we talked earlier?
I didn't want to be He-Man, that's for sure. So I wouldn't be edgy. And also nobody was actually on Skeletor's team. We never had a Skeletor. Everybody was on the goodies. I don't know who we were fighting, probably each other, but it certainly wasn't saving Eternia. The power mechanic is great because one thing that I think was prevalent is the fact that power grows during this particular game. There was Michael gave an example of He-Man in there's some kind of canyon or something, and he was fighting hover robots, I think he said, which yes. is extremely prevalent in the cartoon. And again, one thing I noticed is that they were very clear not to use certain types of fighting words because this was not actually in the cartoon. When cartoons were developed in the 1980s, and they're very clear to avoid violent confrontation. And so there's always a different type of out or a different type of destination or outcome from a particular engagement rather than fighting, throwing robots around and that type of stuff. And it sounded that actually manifested itself in the game. So that would be great to see little cool things like that.
Absolutely. And then, you know, this whole idea of power, we'll get into the gameplay a little bit more, but one of the things that Michael Chennault took a lot of time to make sure was very clear is that there's a controller and it's a one versus many game, but it's a competitive game. And it's not like a dungeon master who's there kind of facilitating a story for the characters, the other players. You will be head to head in that competitive mode. So it's not not like a narrative. I mean, there's narrative scenarios, but it's not like a dungeon master like you might see in like D&D or something like that.
Yeah, you know, that's such a fine line to walk, especially with Dungeons and Dragons, because if you think about people who take on the responsibility to curate the game, it's such a responsibility. So I think that having a system like this where both parties are equally involved, and also bear in mind that you don't have to play as the good guys all the time.
Right.
You can play as the bad guys as well. I think that's going to add a whole new dimension to things. So I'm excited to see what they have and how it actually looks and feels and how it would play. But I think they gave us quite a lot of information. In addition to the stream, there have been a few developer diaries with a few little tidbits here and there. But I think when we saw this live stream, they've really expanded on what they have in mind. And it sounds extremely promising.
With that being said, let's take a look at some of the other characters here, like Trapjaw. Just talking about the dynamic poses again. This is just fantastic. Like he's leaning back, like firing, just such a dynamic pose. And you can see he's got his attachments like on his hips there. And they even referenced that the little notch on his head at one point had to do with like a zip line component, and that they're trying to like work all these elements into his abilities in the game. And so that he's going to have kind of like modular play style. I mean, that's just so cool.
It does. It really opens things up. You know, you can see from the miniature himself, like he's like bracing after firing off some kind of like laser salvo. But yeah, the other attachments as well. I wonder if they actually feature in potentially abilities within the game or something. Maybe there's a mechanic where you can swap out your arm. I think they made it sound like he had multiple strings to his bow. So it'd be interesting to see how this actually plays out. And also one thing to point out as well, it's a slight departure for Seamon. I haven't seen this in the games before, but all the bases seem to be sculpted here as well, which yes. I think is indicative of maybe what the play surface looks like or something. But it's great to see that you know, it's very attractive out of the box to see the fact that the bases already taken care of, so you don't have to sort of fudge about with that.
And I mean, I honestly, I just keep falling in love with all these miniatures. Looking here at Teela now, you know, just absolutely cool, dynamic. And, you know, I just kept thinking, like, these are going to be so much fun to paint as well. If you're a hobbyist and you like to paint your minis, you know, I'm excited just to paint up a band of heroic warriors, as they're calling them. And what was the other one? Evil warriors, heroic warriors, and evil warriors. Mm-hmm. So we can have, you know, these forces. And these miniatures just look like they're going to be amazing to actually get to paint.
Absolutely. I think they've done a great job with this particular sculpt, because depicting women in a fantasy setting is always very, very challenging.
Right.
But what they've done is they've done a great job at really making it look a very dynamic in such a way that's powerful. And I think that's right. Really, really important, especially with a lot of us, you know, we've got kids and stuff like that. And we really want to be able to game with them and show this messaging. Obviously, with properties from the 1980s, it's somewhat contentious in a way. But I think what Seamon have done have taken that and also taken their sort of care to be very, very inclusive in that regard. And I think this is going to feature into this game. You can see here that this isn't particularly showy for a female miniature. And I think they've really got that right balance between what it looked like in the show and how it's portrayed on the tabletop. So I'm very happy about that.
And then as far as gameplay, I was trying to take notes as they were talking on the live stream. Chanel said this is one of his favorite play styles, that she's the captain of the guard. So she could be played as like a support piece, where she can actually like have like royal guard and be like using them as like a minion master, I think was the phrase he used. Or she can just be like a straight up warrior and like beat everyone up herself. And it kind of hints into this idea of multiple styles of play for characters. Mm. And they mention this idea that there is, it seems like a progression system going through.
Yeah. You know, one of the questions I have is, when do you have to make that decision? Is that a decision out of the gate, or does that happen later in the game? Is that your decision, or do you have to make that decision as a team, or is it maybe that's pushed upon you as to your interactions with the game? So I'm very interested to see how that actually manifests itself. I think choice obviously is great for any game, and also it really helps with things like replayability as well. With the roster of all of the different heroes on He-Man, and I'm not sure how many are supported with this particular license, having the choices within a character but also having the choice of another character, there's going to be a lot of replayability here. So I'm really looking forward to this. Like I said, I've got my favorites, but I really want to try out different, not just the different characters, but different ways of playing the game.
Absolutely. And then, of course, it's not a He-Man game without having Skeletor here. And one of the things they mentioned for Skeletor, I mean, look at this sculpt. This is fantastic. And they're saying, hey, look, you know, there's obviously we're drawing from, you know, some of the 80s properties, but in particular, we're drawing here from the toy line itself. And so he's got not like kind of like the cloth material you might see in the show, but more of that kind of like heavier armor that you saw on the actual vintage 80s toy itself. And, you know, once again, it's like a great menacing pose.
You're talking about the feet, aren't you?
Oh, boy. That was a whole line in the Q&A. I was like, what is going on here?
Yeah. So a lot of people may not expect Skeletor to have feet like that, but that is authentic. So I'm sure a lot of fans, especially collectors, would be delighted to see this on a Skeletor toy. But overall, again, the staff, it was featured in everything he did in the cartoon. So that would be great. But, you know, also, I remember Skeletor as being one of the hardest figures to get hold of as a kid. What happened is the first wave hit the UK. And all the cool ones got sort of like snapped up by people who had just had them. So I was like second wave, and I remember Stratos being available for ages in the toy store. Yeah. Nobody, I think people didn't really want them as much. And so my figures were like that. Didn't really have all the cool ones. So getting to own Skeletor here would be great, because I never managed to achieve that as a kid.
And then last but certainly not least, we have He-Man. And they went with the classic, like, in front of Castle Grayskull, raising the sword, I have the power sculpt. Absolutely fantastic.
Great miniature. But I'm going to tell you right now, He-Man is not my favorite character in Masters of the Universe. And I know that's probably sacrilegious to many who are huge fans of this. But I prefer Prince Adam.
So do you think we'll have... So this is a game that has they said there's three different types of scenario play. So there's PvP... There's one versus many, and then there's like co-op versus AI.
Yeah.
Do you think, because it seems sort of like combative, do you think we'll see Prince Adam and like the alternate characters?
Oh, I don't know. You know, let's put it this way. People who are hugely invested in gaming, like Simon, have got a good track record at really delivering everything on the gameplay front. And if you look at properties like Bloodborne, which you've got in the background there, I noticed, it's very clear that it's not just about the game. It's about bringing in elements which are in the property to be fun when people play them. So if we've thought of it, they have. Let's put it that way. So,
that's,
you know,
that's fair.
Yeah. I want to see what they're doing with it. And I'm sure it's great. But He-Man for me is just a little bit too smug sometimes. You know, I like people who are slightly more fallible, Chase. I think that's why we get on so well.
Oh, wow. All right. So who would you be waiting for? Who are you looking for maybe to see besides Prince Adam? Or let's just say maybe Ram Man? Maybe
Ram Man, yeah. Ram Man was no nonsense. You knew what you were getting with Ram Man. He was authentic. He was always himself. And He-Man never was because he was Prince Adam half the time.
Man like Cringer. Cringer?
No, Man at Arms. No. No, sorry.
Man at Arms is amazing. Now, the question for that is it going to be mustache or no mustache?
Well, the trouble is with Man at Arms, he was complicit in He-Man's deception. So... I think he's culpable as well when it comes to keeping secrets. And what secrets did he keep from everybody else? I don't know. Ram Man was always like the dad
he could make like sentient horses and stuff. Like,
yeah, but I always felt sorry for Prince Adam's real dad. Who was that king? Yeah, exactly. He-Man or Prince Adam didn't really interact much with him. It's always, you know, Man at Arms instead. So, but yeah, the moustache or no moustache, because just people know the original figure was no moustache. And it's one of the biggest, most shocking things. It's like watching Tom Selleck without a moustache.
Right.
Yeah, it's like, whoa, what's happened here? So actually seeing that figure after watching the cartoon, a lot of kids were like, nope, not the one. And I'm sure... there are people who had like drawn that in or something, you know. I'm sure if you look on the secondhand market, you see a lot of Man at Arms available, and you look at the face and you think, hang on, has that got a marker pen on the top of it?
For me, mustache, just, I guess maybe it was because the show also had such an impact on me as a kid. That's just how I saw them. It was living and breathing and moving on the screen.
He was
in
very
animation.
Capable. Yeah. He was always very reliable, a stalwart. So
right.
I think,
plot needed solving, he's there.
But, you know, just looking at Skeletor's crew as well, even though they were bumbling, they had some very cool moments.
Yeah.
So I really hope that we see a lot. And there's quite a wide roster as well. A lot of people think He-Man and they automatically go to the cartoon. But there's a lot more to that property than just the figures which were in the cartoon as well. So be interesting to see how far they go with that as well. Are we talking like first, second wave of Master of the Universe figures, or are they going to go beyond that?
We have maybe this is just my run, but you know, where you have a slightly weird smelling Moss Man. Now, Stinkor, I know, is supposed to smell weird, but Moss Man had a weird smell to it just generally. But maybe that was mine. Maybe it got wet and I didn't like leave it in the sun or something.
Yeah, maybe that might be just your figures, Chase.
Is that a weird memory to have? I don't know. Right? Smell is linked to memories, is it?
I guess. I don't think, I'm sure the viewers would like to leave a comment below if their Moss Man actually smelled funny or if that was just
please, somebody
to do with
back
you.
Me up here. Somebody. There's got to be someone other collector who can like crack a box and be like, yep, something's a little bit off.
I think maybe you're thinking, actually, I confuse some of the characters with He-Man because some of the snake guys, I always kind of get them mixed up a little bit as well.
Yes.
And I can sort of conflate two characters into one sometimes. So,
obviously, some of your favorites are unmistakable, though, right? Like a big, big metal arm, you know who that guy is. It's just, it's in the name.
Michael Chanel.
But you know, that's one of the joys of He-Man too. So he took someone who never has seen it, and you're like, what do you think this guy's called? If they knew the general scheme of how things are named, they could probably guess on some of them.
It's one of the most endearing features of the IP that the people who designed the different characters, they basically obviously had an idea and they made the name as fundamentally descriptive as possible. Yeah, they just basically, it's that word. What it looks like is the word. So that's the part of its charm.
And, you know, there's some that are slight plays on them, like clawful, like because he's a bad guy with claws. He's, you know.
So is that a play on lawful and not being lawful? Or is it just the fact that he's got a clawful?
And he's so awful. It's so awful. Like, I'm so bad, I'm clawful.
So this is multifaceted. Maybe there's a lot more to this.
But you know, this is part of the fun of just going back and revisiting He-Man too, because it is like absurd, but it's also fun. And they kept going back to this idea of like, when you sit down, the miniatures, like, we want to have you kind of like, as you would be playing with your toys back then, smash them to things, et cetera. Mm. You have a story about, you know, leaping over ravines or mountains or things. And in a lot of ways, this is a bit of a trip down memory lane, and it is a little bit of nostalgia, and it's kind of fun to indulge that. And to also see the respect in which they're depicting the characters and making them look cool while also having the knots, the lore. I mean, that's just all like a win-win for me.
It is. A thing that interests me, obviously, I like He-Man. You know, is it my top collector's thing? No, I collect things like Star Wars stuff, and that's what I like, you know. But I think what's going to happen is that a project like this has been designed not just with that in mind. The game has to stand alone and be extremely engaging. And I think that this is the magic ingredient we're going to see from Simon. If you look at the trajectory of some of their games, you know, moving things like Zombicide, some of the other experiences, they've learned a lot over a number of years on how to develop really cool, engaging games. Bloodborne for me is fantastic, and I don't think enough people talk about it.
Oh my God.
I think once you get it on the table, it is a lot of fun. So I think that there'd be a lot of value, a lot of fun in the He-Man property, just beyond the actually people having this nostalgic view of things. I think we're looking at more than just a trip down memory lane here.
And then, you know, there's also new properties coming out. The He-Man Revelations that you mentioned earlier with under the direction of Kevin Smith, you know, that will not be focus of this Kickstarter, but you know, there might be cool ideas. Once you got all these minis and you've got all the rules and the narrative scenarios, like, it's not too hard to make your own and continue on these stories yourself and have fun. And if you got younger kids, like, bringing them in and sharing that, you know, all around, I'm just really excited.
I think I read a press release from last year, I think it was, and I think the licensing manager from Mattel, and I may have got this wrong, my impression of what was said was the fact that there is a push to get these licenses out there once again, to do more with these types of things. So I think that, you know, what we're going to see is multiple different projects which basically support one another. Typically, people with a license want to go to TV. They want to try and do something which is very dynamic. They want to have things like games, a whole variety of different things. I think that this is absolutely going to ride that He-Man Mastered the Universe wave. So it'd be very exciting to see what happens. I'm just curious when we're going to get our hands on it, and is it a Kickstarter? Did they mention that?
Yes, it's Kickstarter. It's coming out in September, but no specific date for it yet in September, just that it's coming. And at the very end, and I didn't write this down specifically, now I'm kind of kicking myself, but they did make it sound like they would be maybe revealing more information before the Kickstarter, like that there might be more information forthcoming, whether that's like developer diaries or something, I don't know.
Yeah.
But you know, what we do know is that the core box is going to have, you know, 32 to 38 ish miniatures. We do know that Beastman, Orko, Teela, Skeletor, He-Man, all in the core box. And then it sounded like, not 100% confirmed, but in that same breath, they did mention Merman and Man-at-Arms. And that maybe kind of makes sense to have as like a part of that core experience.
Yep.
So that gives us an idea of maybe the direction we're going there. That still leaves a lot of room for other miniatures. They mentioned Eternian guards and hover robots, because it seems that the controller is going to have not just... you know, he's got minions. I don't know if that means maybe the heroes also have minions. Maybe it's like, you know, it kind of fills out a battle force a little bit.
There'd probably be some kind of mirror, I think.
And then the other thing was, in the very beginning, it sounded like there was like a misstep or someone said battle mat. And then later on, they clarified it and said, no, it's a battle board. It is a board game, and it's hex based. There is no like tape measures. You're moving on hexes, and there are dice that will be rolled, and you roll to attack, but there's no defense dice. So we kind of get, you know, a little bit of an idea of what these mechanics might be like.
Good. You know, if you look at a lot of games these days, the reactive defense type mechanic isn't always cool now. I think a lot of games, you see the streamlined where it is offensive. And then this is normally controlled via abilities or gameplay mechanics outside of you rolling dice on the defensive side. Sometimes they basically design heroes who have enough health points that they have a pool that potentially this is not as impactful. And then it's based on how you react to this in your turn rather than actually being defensive in your turn. So that makes good sense. It's interesting to see. I love games of hexes, first of all. You know, I'm a huge fan of Shade Jade Spire. And there's also Blackstone Fortress, as I've said before. That I love the way that you can move with hexes. I think this is going to be fantastic. This also sounds like what we're talking about here is the micro rather than the macro. If you look at the Archon project, I think what we saw was like an overall map of Eternia.
Right.
And I think that that's more like, I'm not sure, I don't really know much about it. I think it maybe it's like an area control, or I don't quite know what the mechanics are. I'd love to learn more. So I'm going to educate myself before we speak next time. But from the Simon project, I think what they're looking at really here is like hands-on cartoon fight, you know, figures in hands, having this type of battle. So I think we're looking at the micro here. You're not talking about a region. You are the character and you're doing this stuff to other people.
And it sounds like it's going to be a blast. And I really am appreciative of the fact that it's going to be one versus many. There's also a PvP component, but I'm also appreciative of the fact that there is going to be a versus AI component. Because sometimes it's hard. You know, we hear one versus many, sometimes it's hard to get a bunch of people together.
I don't suffer that, Chase. I normally do okay with friends. So normally get a group of people together. If, you know, but if you're lonely, then we can do something online, maybe. I don't know.
Oh, my gosh. Sometimes it's harder to sell certain properties, though. I've been having a blast just talking to people how excited I am for this property. And I've noticed that for people who are young enough that they maybe didn't get to experience He-Man, it's kind of funny trying to explain the property or be like, look at this. And they're like, what are you thinking? And they're like, that's a little bit different. So hopefully I can win them over the gameplay.
I think so. You know, a solo mode or AI mode has become so important to many people. And I think that this, even before the COVID pandemic, people were looking for these types of stuff. I'm a member of a solo board gaming Facebook group. And people are loving
it. Fury was giving me trouble.
No, I was just trying to get recommendations for you. That's all. Hey, Chase, give this one a shot. You might like this one if you've got struggling to play with people. But one of the games I got recently, just to call out, is Lucky Duck's game, Destinies. Absolutely fantastic narrative-driven, app-supported game, which has a very engaging solo mode as well. So for me, I like it. I like the fact that you don't have all of that baggage of trying to align people's schedules, that you can just get hands-on with it. So I'm excited to see what it is. These AI-type games are getting better and better. It's for sure that it's become a tool in a lot of game designers' arsenals, and this is typically not an afterthought. This is actually happening during the game design process, whereas previously, maybe 2 or 3 years ago, we were looking at things which were attached to a game, which weren't as satisfying. So I think that we might see something pretty cool here.
It's reassuring when you hear it talked about like at the ground floor. Like the first announcement, it's like, we have these things. It's not tacked on.
Good. I've got so many wishes for this particular game, but I guess we're just going to have to wait and see what happens. You know, there's so many different iconic characters and locations and ways that you could play this game. You know, you think of He-Man's, what was He-Man's vehicle called? Can you remember what that was?
Oh, the little like sled thing, the sky sled? Or no, yeah. I got to go look it up. Honestly, it's been fun for me going back and like revisiting and like getting back into things and being like, oh my gosh, I forgot about that guy. Or this thing.
I must admit, looking just through the comments of the live stream, and we'll put a link to the Simon announcement live stream in the show notes here. But a lot of people had a variety of different questions regarding the property. And I think it's fair to say that people are pretty much asking all the same questions. What about this character? What about this? And I remember this from the cartoon. I think Castle Grayskull came up as being iconic and people wondering about that. But, you know, like I said, we know what we know right now. And I'm sure that Simon have a sort of campaign to roll this out over a longer period of time. I can't wait to see what comes next.
And, you know, we'll be following it. And so if you can, take a second and like and subscribe and stay tuned for more He-Man coverage. You know, I want to find out, you know, so one of the things that I saw in the comments that kind of piqued my interest was some discussion over She-Ra. And they're saying, well, you know, it's not a He-Man game. It's Masters of the Universe. Does that leave it open for that umbrella? And then people are weighing in on like, well, She-Ra, certain licenses, et cetera, like, I don't know. So, you know, how wide will this game go? Will there be expansions that incorporate that or not? Is that not a thing? So I'm kind of got my fingers crossed.
Yeah, that's a tough one because with licenses, the devil's in the detail with licenses. And so it's either a yes or a no, and we just don't know. Yeah. So I wouldn't be surprised, but then I think a lot of people would be delighted if other things like this were covered. So we just have to wait and see.
If I can get a game where, you know, one versus many, if we ever get, you get to sit down and play and me versus you and your sister, you get He-Man and She-Ra going, or Ram-Man and She-Ra, and sounds like a fun time.
Well, my sister would actually be Teela.
Teela, okay, fair enough.
So, because, you know, she likes bossing people around and Oh, is that her? We also want to get one. Maybe it is my family. I don't know. So I better make sure it's not my mum. But yeah, no, it's like I said, I think this type of game, given the time when this came out, I think people are going to be looking to play with kids or maybe even grandkids at this stage and really introduce them. I think it's great. And one thing which was very important of He-Man, we haven't discussed this, is at the end, they gave you some practical life advice and basically talked you through the process of being a respectable person in Eternia. So
some life lessons, you know.
Exactly. Yeah. I know that you've obviously remembered a lot of those, Chase.
But, remember, kids, violence never solves anything, but having a sword helps. Like that sort of, maybe not quite.
Yeah, remember, I'll take that one to the playground. Yeah, no. So, no, like I said, there's so much creative space in this project. And I think Simon have excelled doing this with every IP and license. And obviously, I'm a big Simon fan. We've worked with them through A Song of Ice and Fire. Yeah. We really
honestly,
get along
I've
well
got
with those
a
guys.
Lot of faith in their capabilities. You know, Bloodborne is not an IP that I'm necessarily like a super fan of, and that the gameplay and mechanics, I mean, I own it because it was such a good game.
Yeah.
And just to, you know, to have this game come along with a really interesting, you know, idea of this one versus many and have this theme that I'm interested in. It's a great trip down memory lane. It's a kind of a win-win. So I'm eagerly awaiting more information and excited to talk about and explore.
Yep, I think we'll definitely have more shows on this subject. And as we know more, we'll be covering more.
And if you guys are experts out there, I've been checking out like the He-Man forums, definitely the Reddit as well. If you guys know other places I should be going to look for information, or if you are experts on the subject, let us know in the comments below some of the things that we should be looking into, maybe even people we should be connecting with. I'd love to get some people on here as guests to talk about their experience with He-Man as more information about this game comes out.
Absolutely. We need to learn more from experts. So if anybody out there is connected to maybe the cartoon property or maybe even the collectability aspects of the figures, we'd love to hear from you. So please, you know, join us. And I'm sure Chase will create another little character for each individual person.
I mean, someone's got to be the sorceress at some point, but we'll see.
I'm good with Ram Man for now.
Okay, fair enough. You look very, you know, stalwart.
I'm growing into it, Chase.
And thanks so much for tuning in. Catch us next time. And in the meantime, we hope we get your miniatures on the table.